Welcome everyone. So today I'm very, very happy to introduce Katusha. It's kind of hard to say exactly all the things she has done, but she's a professor at Ecole Polytechnique. She's director of research at INRIA, and she has been leading essentially research in quantitative information flow, in formal methods and privacy. She even invented differential privacy in metric spaces, for example. And today she's going to talk to us about fairness. And she's been working around this for the past few years. So I think we'd better listen to whatever she has to say about it. So Katusha, the stage is yours.
Actually, for me, it's a rather new topic. So, maybe I'm going to say something very naive. I assume that most of you are familiar, at least, with the basic problem, right, of fairness. So I will not provide too much motivation, and I will go straight to the main result of this work. So the main result consists in showing that a certain notion of fairness that was designed to go well with accuracy, namely equal opportunity, in fact, does not always go well along with accuracy. In fact, there are even cases in which it's impossible to get equal opportunities and an accuracy that is higher than that of a trivial classifier. So it's a pretty strong impossibility result, I would say. And it's going to be, as I was telling Giovanni, it's going to be a bit technical, this talk, because I think the main contribution of this work is the methodology that we have used to show this result. And I think that this methodology can be useful also to reason about trade-offs with other notions of fairness and other notions like privacy and things like that. Okay, so let me start with the I cannot go on with the. I am not able to. Okay. Sorry, maybe I should stop sharing screen and start again because there is something strange. No, it doesn't work.
What if you click on the arrows down below? I know it's not ideal. Okay. That seems to work, right? To go forward, not the central one, just the right one, maybe? If you hit pause, so the middle one. And now you click the right one, the one on the right. That one to advance.
Okay.
It's not ideal, but yeah.
This seems to work. So let's start with a little bit of motivation. So as you know, there is a problem of an ethical problem in machine learning. Namely, it appears that machines are even more biased than humans when it comes to take a decision. So the risk of unfair decision is amplified by machine learning, and this can be due to various causes. One of the main reasons is that machine learning is based on correlation. The training is based on correlation and not on causality. So there could be the risk of a bias induced by correlation, strange correlation that might happen just by chance. And then on top of that, of course, the training data might be already biased because often they're based on decisions taken in the past by humans that might have taken unfair decisions. So a very famous example is this system that was used to predict recidivity of people who had committed the crimes. So based on this machine, people would be let free on parole or put in prison based on essentially on their profile. And it turned out that this system was very heavily biased against Black people. So there were some famous cases in which a poor girl who had committed a very minor offense was put in prison for several years, and she was Black, whereas a white guy that was actually a real criminal and had been freed on parole, and then afterwards he committed some killing, I think. So anyway, it's clearly a big problem. And so this has prompted researchers to investigate how we can mitigate the problem of biased decision in machine learning. And this topic is really exploding. There are tons of papers that have been published in just the last 2 or 3 years. Conferences on the topic that are springing like mushrooms, as we say in Italian. And on top of, apart from that, it's, I think, a very exciting topic. It's an important problem from the social and economic point of view, and it can be approached with the mathematical methods and also with the beautiful mathematical methods. So let me introduce the formalism that I will use during my talk. So I will use these symbols for the important quantities of the data model and the predictor. So when I say predictor, I mean classifier, essentially, a machine learning model that takes a decision trying to imitate the real decision that should be taken based on the data. So I will use A to represent the sensitive attribute, for instance, the race or the sex, or anyway, any attribute that we don't want to be considered when taking the decision. I will call X the set of legitimate attributes, so those on which the decision should be based, and Y for the decision, for the real decision, for the true decision, and Y hat for the prediction of the classifier. Of course, these are all correlated, X and A can be correlated, so even if we try to, so removing A from the set of attributes on which we do training is not a solution, because Y can be correlated to A via X, and so X can be a proxy for A, so the sensitive attribute can be revealed in the decision, I mean, can bias the decision even if it's not present in the data training, in the set of data for training. As an example, I will use this example for illustrating various notion of fairness. So consider, for instance, a system that helps a bank to decide whether a certain application for loan should be granted or not. So ideally we would like that this decision is taken based on the capability of the person to pay back the debt, to pay back the loan. So if it has a good stable employment, if it has a good income, and things like that. And on the other hand, should not be based on the race. So if some black people has a good salary, should get the loan, why not? So this, of course, does not always happen, because there is a strong correlation often between having a high salary and being white. So the machine learns this correlation, and it might, because of that, it might refuse a loan, or it might provide a loan to a white person that is not enough salary to pay back the debt, or vice versa. It might grant, it might deny the loan to a black person who has a high salary. So the oldest, I'm going to introduce two or three notions of fairness, because as you know, there is really a lot of different notions, often in contrast also with each other. And I think it's important to recall the most famous one, just to see how they differ from each other. So the oldest one probably is statistical parity, which is expressed by this formula here, saying that the decision should not depend on the sensitive attribute. By the way, I forgot to say that the sensitive attribute is binary in this talk, and the decision is also binary, positive or negative. Whereas X, the legitimate attribute, can be, I'm assuming that it is discrete, but in principle could be also continuous. So the notion of statistical parity, as expressed here, is a very strong notion, and is not very useful because it's too strong, essentially, and is practically, I mean, if we really wanted to implement a statistical parity, we risk to lose all accuracy. For instance, in the example of the loan, could very well be that the income status is unbalanced between the races. So in general, white people have a higher salary than black people. So if we really want to satisfy statistical parity, this notion of statistical parity, then the predictor should grant loans also to some of the people which don't have enough income to pay back the debt. And I think the bank would not be very glad about that. And also not the person himself, because if he cannot pay back the debt, he's going to be in trouble. So another notion, a refinement of this notion, and this is actually a notion that I like a lot, is the conditional statistical parity. Namely, we impose the independence of the decision from the sensitive attribute, but unconditioned on the value of the legitimate attributes. So, in other words, if X here, for instance, is the income, if this notion essentially says that as long as the decision depends on X, I don't know how to express it. So as long as there might be disparity in the decision, but the important thing is that this disparity is justified by the legitimate attributes. So could very well be that the bank gives the loan more often to white people than to black people, but can be justified if it happens that all these white people who get the loan have high salary, enough salary to pay back, whereas the white people, the black people who are refused the loan, don't have a high salary to pay back. So this notion of disparity would be accepted according to this definition. And to me, this looks very good, as a very good notion of fairness. However, even though there is this conditioning on X, it still affects, it still has a negative impact on accuracy. And essentially because of that, few years ago, Hart, Price, and Srebo proposed another notion of fairness that is called equalized odds. This is the one you see here in the slide. And essentially makes the decision dependent, the decision of the the prediction of the classifier dependent on the true decision, on what should be the true decision. And of course, we are sort of, this can be a good notion of fairness if we sort of assume that that the true decision is unbiased. Of course, if the data themselves are biased, then we need to correct them first in order to apply this this notion. But assuming that Y is unbiased, then this notion means essentially that the training does not introduce any additional bias. So in our example, this would be that the probability that the predictor takes the right decision, namely the decision accordingly to the Y, is not depending on the race. So this notion is also a more relaxed version that is called the equal opportunities. And it is less strong because it only requires the equality of the two probabilities for the positive decisions. So if someone deserves a loan, then you should get it. You should have the same probability to get it, whether or not it's black or white. If someone does not deserve the loan, then we don't care too much. That's the idea. Okay, so the reason why, as I was saying, the reason why this notion has become so popular is because it is there is a sort of belief that it is fully compatible with accuracy and privacy. And the rest of this talk, I'm going to show that this is not always the case. It depends heavily on the distribution on the data set, on the data model. So let me first recall some basic notion. So as you know, I'm going to speak about accuracy a lot. So let me just recall that the accuracy of a classifier is the probability that the prediction coincides with the true decision. And as you know, the best possible classifier, so the classifier with the highest accuracy, is the bias classifier, which is defined as the classifier that always takes predict the label with the highest probability for a given set of features. And the accuracy of the bias classifier is the one you see in the last box here. Now, let me also introduce the notion of a trivial classifier. So a trivial classifier is essentially a classifier that in which the output distribution does not depend on the input. It does not mean that it's the constant classifier because it can be probabilistic, so it's a bit strange to call it constant, but in a sense, the probability distribution on the output is constant, does not depend on the input. And also among the trivial classifiers that can be better or worse in the sense of accuracy, of course, the best trivial classifier is still pretty bad, But anyway, it's defined as the trivial classifier that provides max accuracy. And this is, of course, given by taking the decision which has the highest probability across all the data or across all the distribution of the features. And of course, the trivial classifier has the same accuracy as the probability that the probability of the decision being the one with the highest probability. Sorry, seems a bit circular as a definition, but is given by the formula in the last box. So, a cute result that came out a couple of years ago was by Rachel Cummings and her colleagues, and she proved that, she was also investigating how well equal opportunity goes with accuracy, and she discovered that if you also want differential privacy, if you also impose that your model satisfy some differential privacy, meaning your algorithms to produce a model satisfies a differential privacy, then you cannot do better than trivial accuracy. More precisely, for any epsilon, there are data models, so distributions on the data, for which any classifier that satisfies epsilon differential privacy and equal opportunities cannot have greater accuracy than the trivial one. And later on, another researcher, Agrawal, proved that this is true even if we consider a relaxed, an approximate version of equal opportunities. Namely, instead of requiring the quality of the two probabilities, we consider a bound on the difference between the two probabilities. So even with this relaxed, even if we allow a little bit of equal opportunity loss, still there are distribution for which we cannot do better than trivial accuracy. So I think this is quite strong and nice result. But we came up with something even stronger. So our main result is that we don't actually need the differential privacy constraint. We proved that there are distributions for which any classifier that satisfies equal opportunity cannot have a greater accuracy than the trivial one. And I think this is pretty bad news for equal opportunities. So in the rest of this talk, I'm going to show how we proved this result, mainly because I think the method is quite, could be valuable to prove other results of this kind. So let me introduce this notation just to simplify the formulas. So I will call pi xa the probability of x and a, the joint probability of x and a, and qxa the probability that the true decision on x and a is positive. And similarly, rho xa is the probability that the prediction on xa is positive. And we will call the model deterministic if in the distribution of the data, the probability of taking a positive decision for any given x and a is either 0 or 1. So there is only for each data point, for two data points which have the same x and a component, the decision must be the same. And similarly for the classifier, we will call it deterministic if it is an hard prediction. So it always gives either 1 or 0, but not on the same x and a. And in general, in this talk, I'm going to assume that the data models and the classifiers are probabilistic, and unless we specify otherwise. Anyway, some of the important classifiers, like the Bayes classifier and the optimal trivial classifier, are of course deterministic. So, I'm going to show sufficient condition for a distribution to be an example of the impossibility result, namely that we cannot do better than the trivial classifier if we have equal opportunity. So, for this purpose, I'm going to consider a partition of the set of legitimate features into sets X1, X2, and impose a constraint on the data model, which is the one you see here, namely the probability that the prediction is one, sorry, no, not the prediction, the probability that the true decision is one on XA is Q1, if x is in x1 and a is 0, is q2 if x is in x2 and a is 0, and is q3 otherwise, namely if a is 1. And we assume that q1, for the time being, I only need to assume that the q1 is smaller than 1 alpha and q2, q3 are greater than 1 alpha. And I'm going also to assume, and this is completely without loss of generality, that the probability, oh, I'm sorry, it's not the prediction, it should be the y without the hat. So the probability of the decision to be positive is greater than 1 alpha. So next, so I am going to introduce this notation alpha, which is this, which alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 are three quantities that depend on the data distribution in the way defined here. And similarly, I'm going to use R1, R2, R3 to denote essentially the accumulation of the probability of the of the features X and A on the partition that I've introduced before. And then once we use this notation, the equal opportunity constraint can be rewritten in the way you see in the first formula. Now, the interesting thing is that because of the way they are defined, this alpha I ranges between 0 and Ri. And it is 0 if the probability of the right, sorry, the true decision is deterministic and is always 0 on XA. And this Ri, if the same probability is 1 in XA, the corresponding partition. So this is to say that I forgot to say, all the other values are possible. All the values between 0 and R1 are possible given the constraint that I have introduced before. So it's a convex set. So this alpha I that represent the values of classifiers constitute a dense set in between 0 and Ri. So if we consider now the triple to this alpha I for I equal 1, 2, 3, and we consider a system of coordinates based on this alphas, we can see that So if we consider alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 as a system of Cartesian coordinates, we have that every pair data model and predictor can be mapped into a point in the three-dimensional parallelepiped that is in between these values of alpha, the alpha highs. So the vertices are 0, 0, 0. You remember that alpha I goes between 0 and Ri. So, and assumes all possible values in between. So, so we really have a parallelepiped. And the important thing is that the equal opportunity is a linear constraint on the alpha I. Let me go back for a moment to show. So you see equal opportunity is just an equality of various quantities that are essentially product and sum, scalar product and sum of the alpha I, right? So it is a linear constraint, and therefore it can be represented as a plane, in three dimension. And in fact, this plane colored in blue. So it passes via the zero, the origin. It passes via the point R1, R2, R3. And the other point, W1, that you see here, is obtained by solving the equation. Essentially solving the equation of the equal opportunity gives all these possible values. Gives also W2, but that's not interesting. W1 is the interesting one. All right, so essentially all the classifiers that satisfy equal opportunity with respect to this particular data model live in the blue plane. Another interesting thing is that if we consider an approximate version of equal opportunity, namely we consider the difference between the two probability, and we call it equal opportunity loss, then the classifiers for which this loss is positive are all in the colored part of the parallelepiped, and those for which it is negative are in the transparent part. And furthermore, because of the assumption that I gave at the beginning on the values of Q1, Q2, and Q3, we have that the bias classifier corresponds to the point 0, R1, R2, so is this point here at the bottom. Whereas the trivial classifier corresponds to the point R1, R2, R3. By the way, do you see my cursor if I move it?
Yeah.
Ah, great. All right, so now to conclude the proof, we have just to show that the V max triv, so the point that corresponds to the trivial classifier with the maximum accuracy, is the point in the plane that has highest accuracy of all the points on the plane. And to this purpose, I need to rewrite the accuracy using our notation. So manipulating the accuracy a bit, it turns out that is the formula that you see here. And now the nice thing again is that this is again a linear expression on the alpha. And so we can apply the method of the simplex to find out where the optimal value of the accuracy is. But we don't actually need to apply the simplex because we can reason, there is a more immediate reasoning. Namely, we can observe that the accuracy is monotonic for this particular constraints on the QIs. we can see that the accuracy is monotonic, monotonically increasing on alpha 3, but monotonically decreasing with alpha 1. Before that, we can see that the accuracy is monotonically increasing on alpha 2. And this means that every point on the plane, on this blue plane, has a corresponding point on the red line that is dominated by a point on the red line, right? Dominated in the sense that there is a point on the red line that has better, at least as much accuracy as the first point. So this means that we can just reduce to consider the points on the red line here. And now the problem is, when does it happen that the maxim, the V with max triv, so the trivial classifier, has higher accuracy than W1, right? We only need to consider these two points because, of course, the accuracy being a linear expression, all the points in between have an intermediate accuracy between these two extremes. So by considering these two points, we find out another constraint that is the one you see at the bottom here. Namely, for all the classifiers that satisfy this constraint here, we have that the accuracy of the trivial classifier is better than any other equal opportunity classifier. So this is, you might ask now if the constraints, first of all, are satisfiable and how many solutions there are. But in fact, if you remember, these constraints are imposed on vectors which are essentially independent from each other, because although they are all probabilities, are independent probabilities, they're just the conditional probability that the decision is one for certain x and a, or that the prediction is one for certain x and a. So they're all free variables essentially, and we have a lot of free variables and very few constraints. Lot of free variables because if you look at them as points, as vectors, sorry, their components are all the x's and the a's. So even if we have many values possible for x, these vectors are really a lot. So we have a lot of solutions to these constraints, and in particular we have analyzed some of them. We have plotted all possible classifiers which satisfy certain values of QIs, which satisfy the constraint. For instance, this is one of them. So these points, this blue parallelepiped represents the region in which all classifiers live, projected this time not along the alpha 1 and alpha 2 and alpha 3, but rather in the system of coordinates that that has as horizontal line the error, so it's 1 minus the accuracy, and then the vertical line the loss of, sorry, I used a different name, but it's the loss of equal opportunities. So the points that you see in red, interestingly, are the corners of this region. You should imagine this region in several dimensions. I mean, it's as it should be. So the red points at the corners represent the deterministic classifiers. And this point here with the cross represents the bias classifier, so the one with the highest accuracy among all possible classifiers. The third point, the stream of this the other extreme of this orange line, this one represents the trivial classifier with the best trivial classifier. And all the points in between, so this orange line represents the Pareto optimality curve of the accuracy with respect to the equal opportunity loss. So this is interesting because, as you can see, it's not true at all that they go in the same direction. They go in opposite direction. When the error increases, when we have more accuracy, then the error decreases, and we have to go up in the equal opportunity loss, so we increase the equal opportunity loss, and vice versa, when we have when we want to decrease the equal opportunity loss, then we have to accept a decrease in accuracy, so the error increases. So this shows that for certain distribution is not true at all that equal opportunity goes along well with accuracy. There is a trade-off, there is a tension, just like in all the other definitions, all the other notions of fairness. Okay, and I think this is the last slide, and of the conclusions. So in this talk, we have proved that equal opportunity can be at odd with accuracy, contrary to the common belief, and we have given a sufficient characterization of the distributions for which this happens. But the thing we are most proud of is that we really like the method that we have used. It's geometric, and in particular, is geometric in three dimensions, so we have been able to reduce it to the essential variables to three, and this helps a lot with the intuition. And we think that the same kind of methodology can be applied also to investigate other trade-offs with different notion of fairness or other notions that are important for ethics like privacy. In the future, we plan to perform experiment on real data to see whether this distribution that we have found for which we have this tension between equal opportunity and accuracy, a real distribution, so I mean, it can really happen in practice or are just contrived. I mean, at the first look, they don't seem contrived. They give a lot of solutions, and some of them look pretty reasonable. I mean, not very skewed or not particularly strange. But yeah, everything theoretical needs eventually to be validated by practice. So we are going to perform these experiments. And then we want to use this method to investigate the trade-off for our notion of fairness. And in particular, we are interested in characterizing the distributions for which removing the sensitive feature during the training phase improves fairness without affecting accuracy too much. This is, I think, important for two reasons. One is that in Europe, the notion of privacy, I mean, the constraints about privacy are much stronger than, for instance, in the States. So this means that often we need to train our model without using the sensitive feature. And we want to know whether this affects accuracy too much or is something that, in fact, helps at least to improve fairness. And I think it really depends on the data distribution. You might ask, how do we know the data distribution? Well, I think that doing enough sampling, we can get a reasonable, good feeling about whether the distribution is a good one or not for this goal. All right, this concludes my talk. So some shameless publicity. I'm looking for postdocs to work on privacy and fairness. So if you know someone who could be interested, please send him my way. And that's all. Thanks a lot for listening to me.